Hello everyone and welcome to the webinar today on the role of Zakat in the provision of social protection, which is being organized by the International Policy Center for Inclusive Growth and UNICEF MENA Regional Office, and is being hosted by the socialprotection.org platform. As you might know, this webinar is part of a series with experts on social protection in MENA and is organized by the International Policy Center for Inclusive Growth and UNICEF MENA Regional Office. You can join the online community on the social protection in MENA if you are interested in following the most recent discussions specifically on this topic, but other topics on social protection. Today's webinar is a very interesting one. It will be focusing on Zakat, which is a key social protection mechanism in Islam that aims to provide in-kind and in-cash transfers to Zakat eligible categories, which predominantly focus on the poor, marginalized, and most vulnerable groups in the society. One important aspect about Zakat implementation in the MENA region is that it varies from one country to another. There is this broad spectrum where at one end, we have Zakat fully regulated by the government and is an integral part of the national social protection provisions. And in another end of the spectrum, governments does not regulate Zakat and is considered as a religious obligation to be done by people. And in the middle, we find countries where Zakat is regulated and co-regulated actually by civil society, by communities, by individuals, and by government. So today we will have an opportunity to learn more on the role of Zakat as social protection in the MENA region. And we have two very interesting experiences from Sudan and Algeria, from two distinguished presenters, Elamin Ali from the Zakat Chamber in Sudan. And his presentation will be simultaneously translated by our colleague in UNICEF Sudan, Al-Mu'az Ismail. And also we have another distinguished presenter, Dr. Zine Barka from University of Tlemcen in Algeria. Then there will be around a 10 to 15 minute discussion led by Mr. Mohammad Pournik from UNDP Sudan. And basically, the presentation on Sudan will be on the snapshots on the experience on the Sudan Zakat Chamber. And for the Algeria one, Zakat as a complement to cash transfers to alleviate poverty in Algeria. So we would like to introduce the discussant, but I think you know we went by the previous presenters. Just also to focus that Mr. Al-Amin has a very long experience on the Zakat in Sudan. He's currently the Director of Statistics and Information in the Zakat Chamber and has long, of course, experience in Zakat. And in 2011, he worked as the Executive Director of the Comprehensive Update of Targeting Lists of Families Living in Poverty in Sudan, which is a major undertaking. He holds a master's degree in business administration and a post-diploma in computer science and a bachelor degree in statistics and applied sociology. For Professor Zine, next please. For Professor Zine, he's our second presenter. He's currently the professor of public finance and also directing a research team on public finance in the University of Tlemcen in Algeria. And previously he was the director of Faculty of Economics. Last year, he presented a paper on Zakat as a resource complement to cash transfers to face poverty alleviation in Algeria, which was held in Iran last May. And it was a very important conference on social policy in Islam. Next. And our discussant will be Mr. Mohammad Pournik. Mohammad Pournik retired from UNDP in 2013, where he served as poverty practice leader at the UNDP Regional Center for Arab States in Cairo from August 2009. He has very long experience in the MENA region as he joined UNDP Iran in 1984, and he worked in various countries. In the MENA, he worked also in Sudan and in Yemen. And he has a PhD degree from and a bachelor master's degree from American University, SOAS, and University of Sussex. Next. And I'll be your moderator. Very briefly, I am working as the social policy specialist in UNICEF regional office since 2016. My experience mainly is in social policy and youth programming and HIV prevention. So basically our presentation today, next please. So our presentations, we will have the two presentations followed by the discussions. And please don't forget to send your questions to the panelists in the chat bar. And please write, in addition to your name, write the country where you are working in. The first presentation will be the presentation from Mr. Al-Amin Ali Abdul Qadir. And I would like to know there will be a simultaneous translation from our colleague Al-Mu'az. So over to you, Mr. Al-Amin.
Thank you, Buthaina. Mr. Lamin will Mr. Lamin will do the simultaneous translation.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. أرضي مختصر عن أداء ديوان الزكاة وأعطي غرفة الزكاة في السودان. ديوان الزكاة السودان واحد من المؤسسات الرئيسة للبلاد للتعالي تساهم في قضايا معالجة قضايا الفقر وتنفذ السياسات الكلية والقطاعية للدولة وتساهم في مكافحة الفقر.
The Zakat Chamber is one of the main institutions in the country which addresses poverty, and it's also considered an essential tool for implementing macro and sectorial policies of the government that aims to address poverty. And it also, the Zakat Chamber achieved to develop the human capital in the country.
بينتهي الديوان جملة من الوسائل والطرق بيعمل بالتنسيق مع المؤسسات الرسمية منظمات المجتمع المدني لتحقيق أهداف هذه السياسات.
The Zakat Chamber follows a group of methods and works in coordination with institutions that include civil society organization and government official institutions so as to achieve in order to achieve the objectives of its policies.
الشكل الإداري لمؤسسة الزكاة في السودان بتكون من المجلس الأعلى لأمناء الزكاة وده مجلس فيه العلماء والخبراء والاقتصاديين والجزء الثاني من الشكل الإداري هو الجهاز الإداري التنفيذي ده بيكون رئاسة الأمين العام وبقية الموظفين والجزء الثالث في الشكل الإداري هم لجان.
About the organizational structure of the Zakat Chamber, I would like to say that there are three layers or three layers in this structure. The first layer is the higher council of the Zakat trustees, and this layer usually it includes the scholars and the experts guided over by the Secretary General and the staff. The third layer in the structure, the organization structure of the Zakat Chamber.
تجمع الزكاة تجمع الزكاة من مجموعة من الأموال نجملها في الذهب والفضة والمعادن الزروع والثمار الأنعام عروض التجارة المال المستفاد والمستغلات.
It's usually collected from six main groups. We can say that the first group includes gold, silver, and other minerals. And the second group includes the agricultural output. Also, we have animal resources. We have the fourth group, which is the profits from commercial transactions. And the fifth one is the gained money. It's the resource or the money that people gain from selling their assets. Also, the last group is the gained money, which is gained from using assets and employing them for the sake of profits.
توزيع الزكاة وزع الزكاة بنسب يحددها المجلس الأعلى لأمناء الزكاة زي موضوعنا في الهيكل وهذه النسب تشمل المصارف الفقراء والمساكين وديل بياخذوا نصيب 71% من الزكاة الغارمين نصيب 4% من الزكاة ابن السبيل 5% من الزكاة المصارف الدعوية 3% من الزكاة في سبيل الله 2% من الزكاة العامل عليها 15% من الزكاة الصرف الإداري من الزكاة وهذه النسب تعدل سنويا وفق الحاجة حاجة الفقر في البلاد وهذه النسب مستمرة حتى العام 2019 حاليا.
So about the Zakat allocation, the resources that are collected are allocated according to certain approach. Generally, you have a slide in front of you for the people who can see that from 2012 until 2017, the allocation of per percentage of Zakat was as follows. It's the poor and needy, the first group of poor and needy, received in 2017 up to 71% of Zakat allocations. Whereas the group of indebted persons received around 4% in 2017. And for 2017, the figures go like this. The wayfarers who are the who lost their money received 0.5% Zakat allocation. There we have also advocacy, which is 3%. And also in the cause of Allah, and just to give a background on this allocation, it's an allocation that is characterized by flexibility to include allocations for several purposes for public good and interest of the people. And under this umbrella of in the cause of Allah, so several allocations or along developmental lines can take place and are taking place. Also, there is a group of those who work for Zakat, they receive 15%, administrative cost receive 4.5%. These percentages of allocations are adjusted annually. And as per the conditions of poverty.
المجلس الأعلى لأمناء الزكاة زي ما وضحنا في الهيكل بيعطي أولوية للمصرف الفقراء والمساكين زي ما وضح الجدول 71% من إجمالي التحصيل الأولوية في الفقراء والمساكين بتكون للأيتام الأرامل المرضى العجزة والمسنين طالب العلم من أبناء الأسر الفقيرة وتبني سياسات تقديم الدعم في شكل مشروعات تأمين الصحي مشروع الزي المدرسي كفالة الطالب مشروع كفالة الأيتام وممكن برضو التغذية المدرسية تضيفة التركيز على المشروعات الإنتاجية والخدمية وذلك بتخصيص نسبة من مصرف الفقراء والمساكين لها.
As mentioned in the slide, 20% of Zakat allocations go to the poor and needy in terms of Zakat allocation. But within this group of poor and needy, there is also a special focus on and prioritization of categories such as orphans, widows, and older persons, university students, and trustees. There is a focus on reproductive, service, productive and so service projects, and there is a focus on allocating percentage of the total allocations for the poor and the needy reproductive and service projects.
أيضا تقديم الدعم للولايات التي تعاني من مشاكل النزوع والحروب والمساهمة في استقرار وتوطين العائدين، التركيز على المشروعات الجماعية والمشروعات الخدمية التي تعالج غذاء المجموعات الفقيرة، نديم مشروعات في المياه، في الصحة وفي التعليم، المساهمة في دعم مراكز تنمية قدرات المرأة والشباب، ودعم العمل الهادف لإشاعة ثقافة السلام والتسامح.
Also continuing the presentation on the policies that the Council of Trustees of the Zakat Chamber is pursuing, there is a focus on the support to the states that have displacement and conflict problems. And by doing so, the Zakat is contributing to stabilizing the situation in these states that are having displacement and conflict problems, and contributing to resettlement of returnees. Also, there is a focus on implementing group or community projects and service delivery projects such as water, health, and education. Also, there is a capacity development, focus on capacity development for women and young people.
الخبرة العملية الطويلة لديوان الزكاة في معالجة الفقر وغذاء الفقراء أكسبت دراية عملية نستطيع بأن نحدد ونصنف الفقراء، خاصة أن عمل تنسيق مع العديد من الجهات التي تهتم برعاية الفقراء وذوي الحاجات، زي الجهاز المركزي للإحصاء ووزارة الضمان والتنمية الاجتماعية. الخبرة دي جعلت الديوان أنه يضع مجموعة من المؤشرات يعرف بها الفقير، واستعان الديوان في تحسين هذه المؤشرات بالكثير من التجارب والدراسات المتعلقة بالمسوحات المتعلقة بالفقراء والمساكين بغيم الجهاز المركزي للإحصاء.
With regard to the policies, the policies also support the activities that aim at spreading culture of peace and tolerance. And it's worth mentioning here that when we talk about the definition of the poor, the Zakat Chamber is using its long experience in addressing poverty and the problems of poverty, and using its experience to understand and better identify the category, especially because of the disbursement process happens in coordination with the entities that are concerned with poverty and the poor. And those who have specific time to set a group of indicators to identify the poor, and this the chamber also built its work on many experience and studies related to poverty and the poor, and also through these studies the Zakat Chamber used several surveys, as we will hear now from Mr. Elamin.
المسح ده عمل في العام 2011، واستطعنا بأن نحصل عدد الفقراء في السودان ب 2,291,789 أسرة فقيرة على السودان، وقسمت إلى ثلاث فئات: الفئة الأولى الأشد فقرا 330,703 أسرة، والفئة الثانية 1,729,449 أسرة، والفئة الثالثة 231,637 أسرة.
The Zakat Chamber has done a survey which was linked in 2011.
Yes.
And that survey was based on also a previous poverty survey in 2009. So the survey by Zakat in 2011 has identified the poor and categorized the poor in Sudan through that comprehensive survey in 2011. And the result of the survey was three categories of categories for the poor: first, second, and third. With the first category being the extreme poverty, as you can see in the slide, which includes number of households of around 330,000, and the second 1.7 million, and the third one is 231,000.
المحاور الآليات والنظم البرامج في ديوان الزكاة بيعمل على الديوان يعمل له ثلاثة محاور. المحور الأول متطلبات الضمان الاجتماعي بما يشمل من حاجات أساسية للفقراء والمساكين. والمحور الثاني التنمية الاجتماعية بما تتطلب من مشروعات انتاجية وخدمية. المحور الثالث المشروعات الصغيرة والمتناهية الصغر بما تتطلبه من تدريب فني وإداري.
When we talk about Zakat mechanisms, programs, and we can group them in three areas or three groups. The first one is called the first axis, which is the work on the needs of social security, including social essential needs of poor and needy persons. The second area or the second axis, as you can see on the slide, is the social development, including service and productive projects. The third area, program area, is referred to as the third axis, which is the small and micro enterprise business projects, including technical and administrative training.
المحور الأول المطلبات الضمان الاجتماعي بيشمل على عدد من العناصر أهمها كفالة الطالب العلم من أبناء الأسر الفقيرة والتأمين الصحي للأسر الفقيرة وكفالة الأيتام الفقراء والأرامل المطلقات المهجورات التي لا عائلة لهم العجز والمسنون الفقراء أصحاب الأمراض المزمنة ذوي الاحتياجات الخاصة أسر المسجونين والمفقودين.
The first axis, as we said, it's on the needs of social security and essential needs of the poor. And it covers elements such as like sponsoring the students from poor households and also support to health insurance for poor families. Also, there is an under this axis, there is an element of supporting widows and divorced women who have no sponsors. And also there is an element of supporting disabled persons and older persons who are poor. And also supporting patients of chronic medical illnesses. And also under this first axis, there is a support to persons with special needs and also support to families of imprisoned persons and lost persons.
المحور الثاني المحور الاول الصرف على الشرائع اللي بيسموه الصرف الافقي وده اول مباشر وبتتغير الاعتمادات السنوية وفق الاحتياجات هذه الشرائح والمشكلات اللي بتواجهها. يمكن المبلغ اللي صرفناه عليه من 2015 ل 17 4,461,739,986 جنيه سوداني. ويتم توزيع المستحقات بطريقتين بواسطة المؤسسات الراعية لبعض الشرائح زي الصندوق القومي لدعم الطلاب والصندوق القومي للتأمين الصحي أو بواسطة لجان الزكاة القاعدية ودي بتنتشر في جميع قرى السودان تمثل البعد الشعبي للديوان لأن عندنا 20,000 لجنة أو دعم مباشر بواسطة مكاتب الزكاة في كل السودان.
When we talk to the on the allocations on the first axis, the allocation to these categories in the first axis change based on the needs and problems that the segments under this axis face. The amount of resources that were allocated under this axis from the year 2015 to 2017 was about 4.4 billion Sudanese pounds. The allocation of under this axis to segments allocations are dispersed through three ways. The first approach of allocation is through institutions concerned with these segments, such as the National Fund for Supporting Students and the National Fund for Health Insurance. The second way of allocation under this axis is through the base Zakat committees. And just to give you an idea about what is the base Zakat committees, it's like 20,000 committees in villages of Sudan, which represent the outreach arm of the Zakat chamber on villages and rural areas and in the country. The third way of disbursement for of allocation on this
colleagues, sorry, it seems there is a technical problem. It will be resolved shortly.
لكن كان بغير معنا في الشراء كمان.
Okay, we can now hear you, Mr. Al-Amin. Please go ahead.
Sorry, Buthaina. I think the connection has been lost, and we don't know the last slide you have been following up, and the audience were following up with us. Yeah. Mr. Al-Amin has now concluded his presentation.
Okay, maybe the last points on the first access presentation, which is the last slide.
Was it the slide? Was it the last slide about the allocations?
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. So the allocations, as Mr. Al-Amin said, there are three means of allocating resources under Axis 1. There are the first means of allocation or approach allocations such as the National Fund for Supporting Students or the National Fund for Health Insurance. That's the first way. The second way or approach of disbursement is the Zakat committee, which are around 20,000 committees which in the villages of Sudan, which represent the geographical outreach of the Zakat chamber in the rural areas. And the third one of the third approach for allocating resources under this axis, axis one, is through the direct assistance from the Zakat chamber itself. All in all, the resources which were dispersed in over the first axis, area one, from the year 2015 to 2017, were around 4.4 billion Sudanese pound. And that was the last slide in the presentation of Ustaz Al-Amin. Over to you, Buthaina.
Hey, thank you very much for such an excellent presentation. Very informative indeed. Usually, you know, we go to the second presentation, but due to the fact that Mr. Al-Amin might have another commitment, and so we prefer to address the questions from the attendees. And there are several questions for Mr. Al-Amin Ali. The first one is from Shireen Al-Shabrawi. And basically, she's asking, are there specific numbers for the distribution of the 71% of Zakat on poor and needy? And also, how does the chamber use the set of indicators to make sure who is entitled to Zakat? Over to you. Sorry, we have another technical issue in connection. It will be resolved.
Now we can hear you. Mrs. Elamin will now respond to the question from Shireen. As we understand it, as Mrs. Elamin understand it, it's about the specific number of those who were targeted under the 71% of resources allocated to the poor and needy, and by indicators, I think we understand it as the criteria for selection, isn't it?
Yes, anyway, exactly.
Good. Mr. Elamin will now respond.
بيستفيدوا من ال 71% من ال النسبة المخصصة لفقراء المساكين بيستفيدوا منها في المتوسط 1,500,000 وزلة دي بيصلوا من الدعم في السنة.
In a year, out of the 71% of the poor and needy represent about 1.5 million households in a year.
بالنسبة للمعايير اللي بنمنح بها الأسر الفقيرة إنه يكون طب الأسرة عاطل عن العمل جبراً.
The criteria for selecting these households. One of these criteria is that the household head should be the head of the household should be unemployed and did not succeed in finding employment.
ويكون رب الأسرة متوفي وتعول الأسرة امرأة.
Other criteria is that the male head of the household is deceased and the head house of the household is female.
ورب الأسرة يكون يعني الدخل بتاعه أقل من الحد الأدنى للوجود.
Also another criteria, third criteria is that the income of the head of the household is less than the poverty line.
ورب الأسرة يكون معاشي وعنده أطفال في المدارس وهو ذاته مصاب بالأمراض.
A fourth criteria would be that the head of the household is a pensioner in is on pension and with chronic illnesses, and he there are members of the family who need support.
وكبار السن ما عندهم عائل يعولهم يعني كبار السن.
Another criteria is that older people who have no support, economic support. For them.
ورب الأسرة اللي يكون عنده أرض زراعية أو يكون عنده مشروع ما قادر يعني ما قادر يشغله يعني عنده أرض ما قادر يحرث أو يزرع وعنده وسيلة بتاعت إنتاج عربية متعطلة ما قادر يشتغل عليها.
Also another criteria is that a head of a household with an asset that he or she cannot operate and employ such as a land, agricultural land that he or she do not have the resources to employ the land or a transport vehicle that they don't have the money to operate.
No.
Over to you, Busaina.
Okay, great. Maybe we can take two more questions, because for the sake of time, we have to go to the second presentation. A question from Mariam. So she wants to know, how is the Zakat Chamber related to the public administration and government, and if it's completely embedded in the government structure? And her second question is, what is done under advocacy and the cause of Allah areas? Over to you. Colleagues, we are having technical connections.
Now,
are you back?
Okay, no. Yes. Now, Mrs. Elamin.
دائرة الدولة ديوان الزكاة هو هيئة مستغلة تجمع مال عام ويدار بطريقة مخصوصة. يعني الدولة تشرف على وضع القوانين وتعيين الرئيس لكن لا تتدخل في عمل الزكاة.
The state is responsible for setting the laws and the appointment of the head of the zakat, but does not interfere with the work of zakat, which is independent. And the state does not interfere in the collection and disbursement of the zakat resources.
السؤال الثاني على المصارف الدعوية وفي سبيل الله.
With regard to the second question on advocacy and in the cause of Allah.
المصارف الدعوية هي تعنى بالصرف على المساجد وطلاب الخلاوي اللي بيدرسوا القرآن الكريم والمناطق اللي بتعاني من عدم وجود تعليم رسمي يكون فيها التعليم الديني دي بيصرف يتم صرفه عليهم. وفي سبيل الله تصرف على المشروعات المتعلقة بالخدمات اللي بتقدم للفئات الفقيرة زي المياه جزء من المياه وجزء من التعليم دي كلها في مصروفات في سبيل الله ممكن تكون تحسينات كلها تحسينات مرتبطة بالأسر الفقيرة.
With regard to the advocacy, this is a work that targets the mosques and students of religious schools, and also especially in areas where the only type of education available is the religious education, which is referred to in Sudan as khalawi. This is under advocacy. Under the cause of Allah, it's a category or which focuses on the provision of services to poor areas such as water. Such as water and education, and also covers areas such as the displaced person and the DDI, and also in some cases under the cause of Allah, Zakat Chamber engaged in DDR activities and considered in cause of Allah also.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, great. Thank you very much. This has been an excellent experience sharing from Mr. Al-Amin Ali Abdel Qader. Thank you very much, Al-Muaz. We will go now to the second presenter, to Professor Zine Barka. And the presentation will be on Zakat as a complement to cash transfers to alleviate poverty in Algeria. So next, please. Over to you, Professor Zine.
This, yes, to join this conversation, this webinar on Zakat. Well, let me talk about Algeria now. This is going to be my presentation, in fact, as said previously, it was presented last year at a conference in Iran, in Tehran. And let me just click on this. Yes, this research has been done also with one of my colleagues at the University of Mascara. This is Fatima Zahra Kiari. Well, I will be the only one to present the main ideas of the topic. So, in fact, next, please. Do you hear me? Yeah, the outline first. Okay, yeah. I am going to, in the first place, if you want, just a very short background information on Zakat in Algeria. And the second part will deal with Zakat and the poverty reduction in Algeria. We will give some statistics, some data about that, because it should be said right from the beginning that the Zakat Fund has just been established recently at the central level, but also at the local level, at the district level. And we will see also, we will try to highlight the main beneficiaries, how it is affecting the beneficiaries. The third part of this presentation will deal with the field investigation about Zakat, precisely in the small town, mid-sized town in the west of the country named Maskara, where our colleague Kiari lives and works. And as a conclusion, I will be presenting the main results of the study and also its limitations and challenges. So let's be very quick on this background information on Zakat in Algeria. Well, this is of course based on the one of the most important pillars in the practice of religion, which is Zakat. And Zakat is designed, in fact, to fight and to address the issue of poverty among the population. So many studies, in fact, in some Asian countries such as Pakistan, Malaysia, and Indonesia, for example, have done some research and, in fact, using some very sophisticated tools in economics, in particularly in econometrics, trying to test and to verify what is the link, what is the impact of Zakat and the poverty alleviation. So we have, in fact, a whole body of literature. I'm not going through, but just mentioning that, which talks about this relationship, this link between Zakat and poverty alleviation. So, but as far as my the study we are conducting here in Algeria, it is it looks at Zakat as a complement, as an additional fund, cash transfers to fight poverty in Algeria. So it is going to complement something which is already established by the government, and the government has established tools and social security tools and different schemes which address this question, this issue of poverty. But Zakat, since it is an important pillar and we have the money available, so it takes this direction to address and to help the some projects such as the needy and to fight poverty. Well, some facts. Algeria, it is a 42 million inhabitants, that is the total population, and the unemployment rate is around 12%, that was in 2017. Now it should be, it is around maybe 1250, something like that, but it is increasing. And because of that, it is the unemployment rate which is going to affect the population and deprive them from enough resources. And beside that, we have, as I mentioned previously in the previous slide, that we have a Ministry of Family and Solidarity, which is responsible for the policies of social transfers and assistance. So it is going to be to complement the work of this Ministry of Family and Solidarity. And the 20% of the total budget is destined towards to help the solidarity and also social expenditures in Algeria. However, we have some challenges in terms of effectiveness. Unfortunately, it is not going very well towards the people who are really in need. And this is why I found that the research we have conducted, that it is in fact a very small, very limited study. Since we have a sample, very short sample, very limited sample. We will see that when we will go to address this issue in the in Maskara. So Zakat and poverty reduction in Algeria. As I said, Muslims have to pay, they must pay a tax called Zakat al-Mal. This is what I am talking about. I am not talking about other types of Zakat, Zakat al-Fitr, for example, which is done, given when we celebrate Eid al-Adha or Eid al-Iftar. But and also Zakat al-Mal, meaning that it is going to take into account the savings of someone. All the saved money you have to pay, when it reached certain amount, you have to pay a Zakat, a percent. Exactly. This is the, and it is regulated every year, this this amount of money, savings. It is the up to the Ministry of Religious Affairs and Waqf, and which define or announce the Nisab, as called in Arabic, the Nisab of Zakat. For example, for this, for last year, 2017-2018, it overlaps between 2 years, it has been set up at, let me give the amount of Nisab in US dollar, $4,648.49 US dollar. This is the amount. Up above that amount, you have to pay 2.5% of the money. And of course, Zakat can be considered as an Islamic safety net to combat poverty and enhance the welfare in the society. So let's look at now the Zakat Fund in Algeria, because the Zakat Fund has been set up, has been created in, officially, in, by that. Not the Zakat as paid by the population, but officially at the Ministry of Zakat, Ministry of Religious Affairs, in 2003. So as you can see, it is very recent. And the collection of Zakat is done mainly by banks and also in mosques, where they have Zakat committees. I'm not going to talk about that, but they are very well structured, and we can visit the website of the Ministry of Religious Affairs, and we can see the composition, how it is structured. So on the right side of the slide, you can see the total national Zakat in millions Algerian dinar. So it is going up. It is going up from, as we can see, from, let me just, oh no, just, yeah, from 2003 until 2013. Unfortunately, we have not been able to go till the to more recent data due to the availability of the data at the national level. So, but we can see that, of course, for some years we have drops. In fact, the total national Zakat dropped, such as in 2008 and also in 2010. But I will explain, I will come back later on trying to explain, to give at least a couple of explanations on this drop. And on the others, beside the total national Zakat, we have the number of beneficiary families in thousand. As you can see, we can see that the number of beneficiary families has increased quite dramatically between 2003 and 2015. So there is a link. It shows that, in fact, more you get Zakat, more you collect Zakat from the population, the wealthy, those who have the Nisab and above, and more you can help and give to the needy families. Let's now go to the of course, this is the how it is split up, how it is distributed among the needy. Of course, we have 8 categories. It is mentioned in the Quran. And we have 50% of the amount collected go to the fuqara, which means to the poor and also to the masakin, the needy, 50% of the total. And then we have 37.5% directed to investment, to the youth, particularly those who have projects and who want to expand or to engage in some kind of investment, but small investment, small medium enterprise, for example. We can they get some funds to buy some equipment or for their businesses. And the 12.5% is directed to the management of Zakat fund expenses. This is for those who work for for the Zakat. Now let's go to the field of Mascara. Let's see what's going on in the city of Mascara. Well, as you can see, we started in 2003, and we have the data, very fortunately, because Mrs. Chiari has managed to get some inside, in fact, the committee, and to get some very important data. So, very fortunately, until 2017. As you can see again, this is we can see an increase from 2003 to 2017 with a small drop in 2011 and also in 2015. Same causes, I will come back to that later. But I think the most important thing is to see the survey which has been conducted. It is, as I mentioned from the beginning, it is a small survey, 150 beneficiaries of Zakat in Mascara in 2017. So it relates to 17. We found that, in fact, when we split the numbers of beneficiaries, we have women. They come first at around 70%, distinguishing between gender, men and women, 68%. And then when we look at the age, the structure of the age, we have between 31 and 50. They get 50%. It is in this precise category that we have the most fund. And when we look at the status, family status, we have 34%. They go to the married. And then we have widow, and followed by the divorced, and very far at 10% singles. And then this is the what is the use, in fact, the type of income. Is it going to complement something, an income already available, or is it going just to come a little bit as a single income? Well, 42% it goes from the state benefits. They get 42%. 42%, that it is on top of that. And the impact of Zakat, it is to help increase the consumption for the beneficiaries, followed by coverage of medical costs, 26%. And then we have elimination of debts at 8%. And let's look at the challenges for this fund. I think I read some literature in some Islamic countries such as India, Pakistan, other countries, and most funds are faced with corruption in the disbursement of Zakat, meaning that at least it is true, and this is what we are experiencing in Algeria: nepotism and also political interference. Political interference is very important because in Algeria, and the attendees might remember that we have gone through some kind of civil war. It was very difficult. We experienced terrorism, very dark period. And funds were collected most of the time from the mosque to help the people who were fighting against the government, the jihadi people. So actually, when these mosques are very well known, so they have a tendency to... It is finished now. We are not anymore in this situation. But to remember this period, it is still in the head of the people. So when going to the mosque and giving away money for zakat, some people are very reluctant to do that because they don't know exactly what will happen with this zakat. And this is linked also to the because the lack of effective monitoring system. Some people don't want to pay zakat through the government due to the lack of trust in government institutions, also because there is a corruption, there is also some mismanagement and all that, which is not very, very transparent in terms of management of this money. It makes a limit to the fund. As a conclusion, the zakat as a newly established fund is, we can say in Algeria, it is at the beginning, it is a new practice, not a new idea, because it is an obligation. We have been doing zakat, we have been giving zakat from, ever since we have been earning money, but zakat as a fund is something newly established system to alleviate poverty and hardship. It is necessary, it is very important for the government, for the officials, but also for everyone to have first a database on the population if you want to make it more efficient. And this is exactly what the government is trying to do, is very well, also is very much interested in building, in setting up this database, because actually we are talking about subsidies, subsidies policy, and he wants to target the subsidies to the needy people. So it can be very important to converge and to have this this work done very quickly in order to make Zakat Fund more efficient and more targeted to these people precisely who need this this money, this zakat, to make it efficient and to relieve the poverty and hardship on the population. I think this is what I have, since I have covered, completed my time allocated, 50 minutes. Over to you, if you hear me.
Thank you.
Butaima, yes?
Yes. Thank you very much. This has been an excellent presentation, Professor Zane. Very informative. Before we go to the Q&As, I think it will be important for us to go directly to the discussion with Mr. Mohammad Pournik. So over to you, Mr. Mohammad.
Do I have? Is it 10 minutes?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, fine. So I'll try to time myself. First, thank you very much for both presenters for giving us a very good brief into the way that officially run Zakat operations are carried out in two different countries. Now, what's interesting is, first, in terms of contrast and similarity of the two countries. By chance, we happen to be dealing with two countries, each with a population of roughly 40 million people. But of course, we have a very different poverty profile in the two cases, with poverty being more or less a generalized phenomenon in Sudan, with the latest household income and expenditure survey showing that 25% of the population is below the extreme poverty line. While in Algeria, this proportion is clearly much lower, and we can see that the target populations are very different, even though the total populations are the same. The target population in Algeria is only 120,000 families, whereas in Sudan, it's 1.5 million families. Now, again, in both countries, it's a recent phenomenon. It started in Sudan earlier than in Algeria, but in both countries, there has been a very long tradition of people paying the zakat themselves as an obligation. I think it would be very instructive for us to study the pre and post formalization of zakat periods, because it's not as if the Zakat Fund is providing additional funding. The main thing that it does is it turns what used to be provided on a popular basis, on an individual basis, to something that is accumulated and run through a bureaucratic structure. Now, running it through a bureaucratic structure can have both benefits and disadvantages. Our colleague from Algeria referred to two issues of nepotism and political interference, and I have heard the same complaints about the way the fund operates in Sudan. So it's the problem with nepotism and political interference can be both real and perceived. It can be real in countries where the funds are sufficient to cover everyone. But in a country like Sudan, where the total funds collected are really a tiny drop in comparison to what is needed to really pull people out of poverty, the perception of injustice is likely to be widespread. I did a rough calculation based on the number of households and the amounts that are distributed in Sudan, and it comes roughly to 1,000 Sudanese dinars per annum per family. That sort of fund is unlikely to be able to pull anyone out of poverty. So it's might create resentment even amongst the recipients. Additionally, in both countries, you have a mixture of a modern state that is also assuming unto itself responsibilities of a theocratic state. Now, a modern state can justify collecting taxes based on services that it provides, but without declaring itself a theocratic state, it's difficult to justify the channeling of what are essentially religious dues through governmental or semi-governmental institutions. And I think that's one reason why you have some resentment regarding the payment of zakat, because people feel that, okay, if it's my duty, I will pay it myself. Why should I pay it to a government-run institution? The overhead is definitely an imposition that does not exist when the zakat is implemented through a popular system whereby individuals who owe the zakat pay it to those who are in need. And the problem of targeting for a big institution versus targeting when it's done through popular means is also another major problem that I see with formalization of this very sound religious practice of helping each other. Because the thing is that what happens is over time, the numbers who are in need change. Unfortunately, in many of our countries, the change has been to increasing need. And the cost of targeting also is very high when you have large numbers of people who qualify, as is the case in Sudan. So in such cases, I would find it difficult to justify having a government-run system. And also, I'm fully aware of how extensive the social solidarity system in Sudan is. And Zakat is only one part of it. And by taking it out, I think we might be putting too much emphasis on Zakat and setting ourselves up for feelings of being underachievers. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mohammad Pournik. That has been excellent. I think we go now back to the questions from the audience. And we have several questions to Professor Zine. And sorry for not presenting all the questions to Mr. Al-Amin. For the time constraints, but as socialprotection.org colleagues confirmed, they will be answered in writing and posted in the online community. So we have a question from Amal Al-Lhoum from UNICEF Algeria. Her question is on who works for Zakat? Are they a specific group? What is the actual level of administrative costs for the overall targeting, and how is it collected, like the key mode of collection? Is it more mosques or the banking system? And we have another question. Also, is the lack of database the only challenge in Algeria? Shouldn't we consider also accountability and monitoring mechanisms? And this question is for from Mariam. So we will go by these two questions, Professor Zine, and then we will complete with the others. Over to you, Professor. Sorry, maybe we have a technical problem. Professor Zine, can you hear me?
Do you hear me now?
Yes.
Oh, good. Great. Good. Yes. As I was saying that as for the first question, the collection of Zakat is done mainly by the banking system. And in fact, when we visit the website of the Ministry of Religious Affairs, we find that they are providing information and everything needed to send the money through the banking system with everything we need to transfer this Zakat to these funds. At the national level and detailed also from the 48 districts in Algeria, from 48 wilayat, so there is nothing missing on this side. But we have also the other channels. It can be collected through the masjid, through the mosque. When you go to the mosque, we have the imam, we have the committee, but you see the imam, and every time he reminds the community that they can come and give the zakat to this fund, and he will hand them over to the committee at the local level. That's no problem, because every mosque can collect this zakat. And so this is the easiest way The other one, the banking system, is more a little bit difficult for most of the people because we are not very familiar in Algeria with the transferring money from one account to the other account. And most of the people, for different reasons, they don't want to do that, particularly the wealthy, and they don't. They want to keep things a little bit hidden. And having said that, let me address the other question, which is also very important. As I mentioned, we have in 2 years, we have a drop in the amount of Zakat collected. The main reason is when you ask, and it was done for the survey, when you ask the wealthy, you go and try to tell them what about Zakat you should give, and this is the time now, I think you should think about it. They tell you, well, look, if I give Zakat, because I know the people around me, they really, I have the criteria myself, I see them around me, they live around me, and even if they are not around me, but I can see them, so it is much better for me to give them directly this Zakat. It will I will help them, I will give them, I will give them, well, the amount of Zakat, not the total Zakat maybe, because he has also other person in mind to they want to take advantage of the Zakat, but it will be done at least efficiently and targeted, and I feel very confident that Zakat is going to reach the needy. Whereas, for example, if I give you the Zakat to this fund, I don't know exactly how is that going to be distributed or redistributed. How are you going to operate with that? I don't trust this fund. This is a lack, this missing link between the people, those who want to give Zakat, and these institutions, official channels. I don't trust them because of, as I said previously, I mean, this bad management. There is no auditing. There is no control, there is the lack of transparency, in fact, when it comes to the, and also, but on the other hand, the people, they tell you that I'm not going to the mosque to ask for Zakat because I don't want to see my name put on the list of the beneficiaries. This is a shame. I can't accept it. I can't accept that. So it is much better for me to get the Zakat just in a very informal way between two people, not on the list where everyone can see the other ones. They don't like this way of dealing with Zakat. So, as I said, but mainly because it is very efficient when you give it to the people, to the needy. You know them, and you are sure that it is going to relieve them and to help them, because they want they have some debt, they want to cover, for example, some extra expenses, they have some illnesses, so they are in a needy situation, they are divorced or maybe widowed, and they have some extra expenses to face, and it is that way that you filter yourself and you establish these criteria to give to the needy. Whereas, for example, the official level, it is not very 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 clear, not very transparent, and the mechanism is still everything which is backed by the bureaucracy is a little bit not very, very seen as something not very efficient, and is going maybe to be wasted instead of being targeted to the real ones, to those in need. And I should say that because I didn't have the chance to go, that was my fault. In fact, I missed a couple of slides at the end. That the Ministry of Religious Affairs, there is, when you visit the link website, there is not a lot of data. There is not a lot of information. Let me take just two. In Algeria, yes, good. Thank you so much. The website of the Ministry of Religious Affairs. I have just checked before the presentation the website, and we have some shortcomings, something missing. We have Algerian immigration, particularly in Europe or in the world, living in the world abroad, and they, of course, each time, every year, they wonder about their zakat and they want to pay zakat, but the best way, well, they have the possibility to give zakat in the country where they live, but sometimes they want to send the zakat to their home country, to Algeria. So they don't know exactly what to do. And when you visit this website, the window doesn't open at all for those Algerians living abroad. So how do they send the money? What is the procedure? There is nothing whatsoever around it. And also, when you open the window on the website of the Ministry of Religious Affairs, nothing on the window, how zakat is spent, because it is mentioned in the title in Arabic. In Arabic, it is mentioned mentioned, but unfortunately there is nothing. The window does not open at all. How the money is spent. I am trying to find the exact word in Arabic, but there is nothing at all whatsoever. Yes. كيف ستصرف أموال الزكاة? I will look the link. It is named, titled, كيف ستصرف أموال الزكاة? Nothing. This is what I said. We have nothing whatsoever about the zakat, nothing on the window, nothing is mentioned at the local level also, because the data provided by the Ministry of Religious Affairs, they deal with the central level, but not at the local level. At the local level, we have nothing whatsoever. And also on except the beneficiaries, for example, from 2003 to 2005 only. Data collection zakat starts in 2003 and ends in 2009. Nothing after that. It is a little bit shortcoming, which means for me that seriously we are not dealing with the zakat fund properly, and it doesn't give the good impression that we want really to have this money of coming from zakat to the fund in order to use them to redistribute them to the needy, to the people. This is something missing. This is something which should be addressed, I think, at this level of the Ministry of Religious Affairs, since they have started to talk about it. But we have some history, in fact, about that. It started in 2003. That was at the end of what we experienced, as I mentioned, in Algeria, this very difficult period where the fighters, those who were fighting the government institutions, were collecting money during all this period of 10 years, almost 10 years. And so government has started maybe to officialize this way of collecting money through mosque, instead of just leaving the people dealing privately with this zakat instead. Over to you, Bouhanni.
Okay, thank you very much. I think I will only add a very brief question for you, then we will have to go to Mr. Al-Amin. There is a question from Yasmin Ibrahim from Lebanon, I think it's addressed for both you and Elamin, but she's saying, is there any statistics on the share of Zakat of the GDP?
Yes, very good question for me. She's talking about Algeria, but this is almost not significant whatsoever. This is just a very small part, very small share of the GDP of Algeria, and very few studies have been conducted. And also, as I said, because of this lack of data, we can just take the numbers as they are in 2009 and try to compare them to the Algerian GDP, which is much, much higher, and that this is less than 3%.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Zine. This has been excellent. And so we will go to Mr. Elamin.
Yes.
Al-Mu'az, are you still online?
Yes, and Mr. Yeah. Elamin also is online.
Yeah.
Great.
Hi, Martin.
Ahlan wa sahlan. Two more questions for you, Mr. Elamin. One is from Charlotte, from IPC. And she's saying, you have mentioned that women and orphans are prioritized within the poor and needy category. How is this done? And is it done through quotas? And also the same question applies to the prioritization of states with higher numbers of displaced people. Are there quotas? Okay, let's pause with this question. And then if there is time, I will also add another question. Over to you, Mr. Elamin.
الأرامل والأيتام بنديهم أولوية في الصرف يخصص لهم نسبة أعلى في المخصص بتاع الفقراء المساكين. يعني إذا كان الصرف المباشر للفقراء المساكين 71%، نحن بندي أكبر نسبة فيه في الصرف ده، يعني نسبة تتراوح ما بين 20%، نحد نخصص 20%، نخصص 20% اليوم وهم محصورين موجودين. إذا الناس المقدمين 20% منهم ممكن نديهم.
بوسينا أستاذ اللبين says they are already listed. The targeted individual persons are listed. So from these targeted individuals, they do the prioritization of widows and orphans within the 71% of poor and needy.
السؤال الثاني بتاع تخصيص المناطق المتأثرة بالنزوح، مش كده؟ المناطق المتأثرة بالنزوح بنخصص لها مبالغ اللي هي ولايات محددة فيها مشاكل النزوح. في ولايات دارفور بيكون في دعم مركزي، يعني المركز تمشي لهم مشروعات يعني تساعد على إعادة التوطين بتاعهم، تديهم مشروعات زراعية، مشروعات إنه يقعد يستوطن وتبني، تساعدهم في البناء بالنسبة للأسر دي، تديهم وسائل بتاع الإنتاج. يخصص لهم مبالغ من الفقراء ومن في سبيل الله.
بالنسبة with regard to the second question on the states where there are displaced persons, these states are already identified. So the support which comes which goes from the center to these states targets activities such as resettlement of displaced person within these already identified states, and it comes through the
feasibility
in the cause of Allah and the support from the center for the poor right. And needy.
Okay, great, thank you. The last question, go ahead.
It's just wanted to highlight that in 2011, as Mr. Elamin said, there was a survey linked also to 2009 poverty survey. These 2011 resulted in the listing of those who should be targeted for Zakat. And from this, the prioritization, which the question referred to, takes place. Over to you, Busaina.
Okay, thank you very much. The last question for Mr. Al-Amin is from Yasmin Ibrahim from UNICEF, Lebanon, on the share of Zakat to GDP compared to the total government expenditure, if there is any data.
Yes. Zakat, Zakat يمثل 1.3% من الناتج المحلي الإجمالي.
It's around 1.3% of the total GDP. The Zakat is around 1.3% of the GDP as per the figures of 2018.
18, yes.
Okay. Okay, great. Thank you very much. That has been fantastic. Thanks a lot. Okay, I think we are approaching the end of the webinar. And it has been a pleasure. Thank you very much for all of you for joining us. And please, if you have time, become a member of the socialprotection.org and make sure to answer the webinar survey available at the end of this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Buthania.
Thank you.
Shukran.
Pleasure.
Shukran jazeelan.
Thank you.
Thank you.